to invite our next very special interview session guest to talk about opportunities in distressed real estate, asset reconstruction, special situations. I would like to welcome Amit again to be on the other side of the table as a moderator. To introduce our guest, we have Ms. Neeta Mukherjee, who is the CEO of Assets Care and Reconstruction Enterprise Limited, a prominent asset reconstruction company. Neeta has over 30 years of experience in the banking and financial services sector. She has in-depth expertise in the areas of distress, debt, credit, and risk management. Welcome, Ms. Mukherjee. We also have with us Mr. S. Srinivasan, the Managing Director, Kotak Investment Advisors Limited, and co-chair of Africa India Chapter. Srini oversees Kotak Private Equity as well, Kotak Infrastructure Funds, Kotak Special Situations Fund, and Kotak Listed Equities. Overall, Srini manages about $2.7 billion in AUM across asset classes. And Srini has introduced significant financing, financial structuring, and negotiating skills in the alternate assets industry. Oh, welcome, Srini. Good to have you. And as you can see, I've been given a new role at Naredco to be an MC. We also have with us Mr. Nipun Sahni, the partner Apollo Global, one of the world's largest alternative investment managers. Nipun is responsible for the real estate investments business in India. And is also a part of the Asia Real Estate Leadership Team and is responsible for investing across Asia. Nipun has held leadership roles across Merrill Lynch and GE Capital, including real estate investments and structured finance. Welcome, Nipun. So good to see you.
Thank you, Neetu, and a very warm welcome again to our very, very esteemed and distinguished panelists today. I think it's an extreme privilege and delight for me to have with us today Srini, Nipun, and Neeta. I think this is a dream panel for us at this edition of REIS 2020, especially in a time which is unprecedented, unforeseen, and the whole gamut of NPAs, stressed assets, distressed assets have been sounding larger than ever. Just to remind our audience that the whole ambit of stressed assets really started with the introduction of IBC 2016, wherein global participants could come and look at distressed assets in India. However, there has been no greater time than since the onslaught of the pandemic when people have looked at it even more closely. Across the spectrum of investors, we have private equity funds, global funds, and ARCs who are here with us today, who will be able to discuss the opportunity set and what it means in the current environment. It is also stated that, or one of the research reports states that about 72% of corporate loans in the banking system are under stress, and the NPA stands at about 9.3%, which effectively means a $150 billion opportunity within the banking space alone. If you add that to the non-banking private equity and other spaces, it would potentially cross a $200 billion mark. So a sizable opportunity and growing. However, there have been challenges. It is also estimated that about 21.8% of the stressed assets could be in the construction sector as per the RBI Financial Stability Report. So without further ado, we'll jump right into the absolutely sought after panel, which is a maiden panel in this year's edition. And I'm absolutely delighted to first welcome Srini, who is a veteran in the space, has been at the forefront of the distressed asset and insolvency code. So Srini, over to you. And I would like to first ask you by sharing your experiences that you had in dealing with the insolvency and bankruptcy code and real estate stressed assets in the past couple of years.
Amit, thank you. And good afternoon, my fellow panelists, Nipun and Neeta. And Neetu, I have not been able to follow your specific instructions of putting the APRIA banner at the back, which Neetu has been able to do. So apologize for that. I'm technologically not very savvy. Now, coming to the question that Amit had asked. Look, the code itself has been evolving over the last 2 years. our experience has fallen significantly short of what we thought it would be. And it is not as much a fault of the code as it is a fault of the various stakeholders who have been interpreting this code. The most recent example, while the DHFL transaction, for example, is not being done under the IBC code, the fact that when a process is defined and that process is then violated, then investors such as ourselves who have to spend a fair amount of time and effort to make a bid become frustrated. And that, I would say, in summary, it summarizes our position with regard to how the IBC code has actually been working. And I have said this before, and I'm happy to repeat that again. In my opinion, the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code is just not suited for real estate at all, because real estate projects have definite cash flows, and IBC code has been written with the view of having what I call as business continuity or indefinite cash flows. It's very different from buying a manufacturing company where you can earn cash flows for eternity, whereas in a real estate project, there is a finite cash flow. So the code is just not suited for the real estate industry. So to my mind, it's a little bit of a mixed bag. I would say a lot of work to be done. Good news is that the government is listening. They have made some tweaks and changes, but our expectations are much higher than what we have got so far. You're on mute, Amit.
I think the system goes on mute by itself sometimes, so that I can speak less and allow others to speak. Any other key policy or regulatory initiatives that you have been helming are of relevance from a global investor or a domestic investor standpoint, Pini, that you think or believe will pave the way for faster resolution? You just pointed out that IBC may not be appropriate. You've been trying to make changes within the IF and other regulations. So would you be able to share those asks and experiences as well with the audience? I think you've gone on mute too. So we get automatically put on mute.
Absolutely. One of the most important asks has been on behalf of the industry, and both Nipun and I have been party to some discussions with various stakeholders, particularly in the government. And I hope if somebody is from the government is listening to this, we have consistently asked for special situations fund to be enabled the same rights of protection. Tommy, to explain to the rest of the audience, essentially in a real estate project, if somebody is going to put in money for completion of the project, even though there may be other lenders, and if after we put in our money, somebody takes that real estate project to the insolvency process, then our position as a senior lender is completely compromised, because the IBC process will treat everybody pari passu. The Swami Fund has got a special dispensation which protects the fund's priority in terms of cash flow, even if the project is going into the IBC later. We have been petitioning the government, including the Ministry of Urban Affairs, as well as the Ministry of Finance, through all the fora that we have been part of, to give the same protection for SEBI-registered, regulated funds and FIIs. Unfortunately, we have not seen that, because the Swami Fund today addresses the affordable housing. And all of us know that, particularly in Mumbai, I can see that Rajan is there, Ashok Monani is there. 2 crores and lesser, how many projects will really get covered in Mumbai? So the cutoff levels are very low. The troubles are spread across the spectrum. And I think there is a lot of money can actually go into work. And part of the reason why it's not working is this particular restriction. The second initiative that we've been asking the government is to permit alternative investment funds to buy non-performing loans. And I can see that Neeta can smile at it, because this will tread into the territory of asset reconstruction companies. Today, AIFs are not permitted to buy non-performing loans because they are technically not a security. We have been lobbying with the government and with SEBI to try and get that permission going. It's making some headway. The good news is Reserve Bank of India had put out a consultative paper, which it essentially speculates whether a permission like this may be granted. So we are awaiting that approval. So if that happens, fair amount of money can actually come in to rescue stuck projects.
Absolutely. Thank you, Srini. You're one of the foremost managers for real estate and special situations in the country, Srini. You're one of the first. You've actually been at the helm of doing things first and leading the path for the industry. Your special situations or distressed asset fund is no exception to that. How do you see people working with you? What is it that you need for developers to have or bring forth to be able to work with you, to be able to consolidate the industry, acquire such stressed assets, and vice versa? How do you think that you will be able to accelerate the entire consolidation program through your stressed asset funds?
Well, I think, you know, our asks are reasonably simple. I think oftentimes I now find that developers are quite flexible. They have taken the fact that, you know, you need to be more flexible in terms of pricing and so on, which was the case about a year ago or 18 months ago. Developers were still not sort of seeing the writing on the wall to, you know, take price cuts, etc. But I think all of that is, people have realized that, you know, there is a bunch of things that you need to do to actually complete and sell your asset. Many of the things that even if the developer is willing, their hands are tied because existing lenders are not being very flexible. And part of what the solutions that I was suggesting earlier was to, you know, alleviate that pain for developers. I think the other aspect of it is that when we step into a project, it is not as if that today, if you look at the customers are gravitating towards developers who have had a track record of delivery, a long-standing. And you can see that, you know, in the last decade or so, there has been a lot of new entrants, many of them first-time developers. They probably did not know how deep the water was. And in those situations, you know, as far as we as a fund are concerned, we are actually happy to participate with some of the better developers and acquire that project, provide that capital, because we want to, you know, depend upon the skill sets, the brand name and the execution capability of a better track record developer, as opposed to somebody who started this on a first time basis, or somebody had a piece of land and therefore he thought that he can become a developer. So I would say my guidance to the audience here is that if you have a good track record, you know, we are happy to partner with you to take over existing projects where required. We may not be very charitable for first time developers, because we believe that, you know, part of the reason why he may have gotten into trouble is because of lack of understanding of the risks in the business.
I appreciate it, Srini. Moving to you, Neeta, you've been you've effectively been at the forefront of the asset reconstruction business since the advent of SARFAESI over the last 18 years. And the landscape for ARCs may have tremendously changed over this period. There's been a lot of buzz about assets being consolidated through ARCs. So the first question is, because we have other comparable investors, are ARCs better off from a regulatory and tax perspective in acquiring NPAs and stressed assets, Neeta? And what is it that you think will be what ARCs are able to do to be able to acquire these stressed assets and have them turned around?
So thank you, Amit, and thanks for having me here today. So I think, as you know, ARCs were set up following the SARFAESI Act in 2002. And so it's been quite a long journey. And along with the journey, there's been a lot of evolution, both in the number of players, in their level of sophistication, in the changing regulation, and, you know, I guess, acceptance of ARCs and as an integral part of the financial system here in India. So I think what is going for us right now is that we've been at the mainstay of NPL resolution. I mean, I would not say perhaps that we have done a lot in real estate projects, because, you know, sort of the stress in real estate projects is something more recent. But in dealing with large corporates, you know, and finding sort of productive use for assets which have turned unproductive, you know, unlocking value there, and actually kind of taking possession, taking legal recourse, taking possession of assets under SARFAESI and, you know, sort of selling that. So there's been a lot of action on the ground, and sort of ARCs have done a lot, and we are today one of the five largest ARCs. But you know, along with some of my other competitors and the other ARCs, there has been work done on actually resolving some of the large assets. Now, one of the keys in the large assets, of course, whether it be real estate or any other manufacturing corporate, I think the key is about the debt aggregation, because once debt is aggregated, it kind of reduces the number of creditors, reduces inter-creditor issues, and can overall hasten the process of decision making or arriving at a consensus or a resolution. So, I think the key in resolving anything large is about how soon we can get to a debt aggregated position. And of course, two things are required there. One is, of course, willingness of the different sellers to part with their loans. Then you have valuation questions and, sort of softer issues around approval process and, auction process and so on and so forth. And of course, the other challenge is, the availability of capital. So whether it be in an ARC or any other structure, capital is required. You need risk capital to come in. And yeah, again, so an ARC will be successful if they've been able to kind of raise capital. We ourselves have backing of a large foreign investor. Some other ARCs also have, been able to. We work with partners, we work with different stakeholders. We are partnering, some of the other foreign investors, special situation funds who want to make that play in the NPL. And I think that's really been the key. So yes, from where we started, and as you know, I was there in the initial days of one of the largest ARCs in India, and right now this is my next sort of role. Yeah, so we've come a long way, and of course, we welcome, to kind of partner with different stakeholders.
But Nita, in the current environment, do you see a lot more optimism by lenders to actually let go of assets to ARCs like you? Are there more resolutions which are likely to happen with the current pandemic, knowing that holding on to assets in their books is not going to resolve itself? Do you see people willing to take a haircut or, take SRs from you and hand over the assets? Or are you still facing the same historic challenges as before?
No, I think while the acceptance has increased, of course, those challenges remain, because ultimately it's a question about, who will bail that cat? Because, if you take any loan, be it in any situation, and if the loan has been an NPL and it's a carried interest for some time, and so, there's kind of an asset value and there is the loan value, and so there's always that difference in the bid offer spread. And, it's overcoming that hurdle wherein the barrier lies. So one is, of course, valuation gaps, valuation expectations. And the other is, about achieving faster resolution is how can we on the ground overcome some of the legal challenges that all of us face, in different capacities, So how can we just get speedier movement in the courts, whether it be regular courts or the IBC process? So it's all around that.
Has the pandemic caused the NPA portfolios across the banking or the corporate India landscape to only expand? Or do you think that because of the KV Kamath Committee and the restructuring options, there will not be too many options available for stressed assets in the hands of ARCs and your larger global LPs therefore?
So I would put it, two ways. Actually, one is that obviously, the pandemic is unprecedented, and unprecedented is a word that we've all used multiple times in the last few months. So yes, it did require some sort of dispensation, and so the impact will still be clearer in the coming months, because we're still getting out of moratoriums and we're still understanding, or rather the lenders are understanding, which companies or which borrowers could be entitled for a restructuring, because at the end of the day, you can restructure only if there is, ultimately long-term viability. But the second lot will be cases where there was stress even prior to the pandemic, and then those won't merit restructuring under any dispensation. And also, I think the impact is still kind of becoming clearer. The RBI stability report, which you alluded to earlier in, the introduction, they have, projected that for the scheduled commercial banks, the NPA level, which was 8.5% as on March 31st, 2020, would increase to, I think, 12.5% by the end of this financial year. And that is their base case. And, so we have to see how things pan out. Yeah, definitely there will be an increase, and then you have NBFCs as well, which is not in this number of RBI which I just quoted.
So
stress will increase, but how it's panning out in terms of NPL and those which need to get restructured, I think that is still still getting determined.
So last question for you, Neeta, is how likely are you to participate in the real estate sector, and what opportunities do you see yourself as Acres to actually help consolidate the sector from an ARC perspective? Do you see yourself getting more active now, given that there is a new percolation of stress?
Well, as Acres, we've been active. As I said, we are among the top five, and we would continue to play an active role. When it comes to real estate per se, at the end of the day, it will come down to not only valuation, but in real estate, you have the added complexity. In a incomplete project, there are different kind of liabilities, both construction liability issues, and then the entire customer or home buyer, kind of section, which is in a sense one more party or one more stakeholder that hitherto we've not been really dealing with. So I would say that, yes, we would like to do it, but I think we would have to kind of get our feet wet and test the waters and see how it goes because of the complexities being real estate.
I appreciate that, Neeta. Thank you so much. I'll move over to Nipun. Nipun, welcome again. And obviously, you are a veteran of the space. You have been in private equity and credit for a very, very long period of time. Apollo, with $443 billion of asset under management, is clearly a leader in the space. Nipun, what are the key drivers that your LPs are looking from India in the special situations and stressed asset space, especially within real estate, Nipun?
So I think you've laid out the numbers in the very beginning, right? The size of the opportunity is attractive. Investors are very familiar with India across other asset classes, and arms of Apollo and funds like ourselves have been investing in credit or private equity or real estate in general or across various opportunities that India offers. So, India is a place in Asia that investors are looking to do and engage more business with. So I think at the macro level, people get it, but at the micro, or when you come to specific of distressed investing / NPLs, that whole space, it's totally messed up, without mincing words. If you take parts of India financial service system which have attracted capital, insurance got the capital it needed as a segment, right? Take the services side of the business, broking houses, mutual funds, they've all got capital, right? Take the lending side of the business, retail finance, consumer finance, whether it's auto loans, home mortgages, personal loans, all of that through banks or NBFCs, all of them have been able to access domestic and large parts of international capital. I think we have to ask ourselves as to why are we not able to get capital into the space of distressed assets. It's not an investor problem. It's our problem is that, it's like we think everything is okay, but everything is not okay. I think we are able to attract capital to several parts of the financial system, every single part. We fixed it. But somehow we are just not able to get our head, and we've been trying for years. So I think we have to decide if it's $200 billion of NPL and we keep resolving 4, 5, 6 billion every year. You and I could be 80 years of age sitting in 2050 in a Naredco conference and still debating NPL and India opportunity. If you are going to resolve 5-7 billion a year, it's a 30-year problem. So does India want to treat this as a 30-year problem, or do we want to treat this as a 5-year problem and move on? And I think that's where the central problem lies. Everybody we have spoken to, Srini and I, like he mentioned, are part of certain debates. Everybody gets it, but it's not Prime Minister Modi's job to fix this. Like, everything can't go to the PMO, right? And I think there are too many stakeholders. There are multiple stakeholders amongst the regulatory side, on the ministry side. Like, who will bell the cat? It's not priority. It is. Like, people are seized of the matter. I think so. Now, over the last 10 years, I think there's a very good understanding of the issue. I think people also understand the solutions, not rocket science. We are not discovering a vaccine for COVID here, guys. That's complex, right? We are not trying to inoculate 7 billion people. You know, we are just trying to fix NPL. How tough can it be? And I think we've just made it tough for ourselves. You know, investor, there is enough and more capital. I think every time this question comes up on capital, it's not a capital problem. Take e-commerce in India. You know, we've put in billions of dollars. Only 1% of that has come from India, and 99% of that has come from international investors. Take, I can give you examples after examples where the ratio of, you know, it's like 5 to 10% domestic, 95% international. So it's not a capital problem. So let's not, it's the wrong question. The question is, how do we make this into a five-year solution than a 30-year solution and sitting in, you know, we've had these debates on NPLs when I was at G Capital in 2000. We are in 2020, guys. You know, we are still debating how to fix the problem. So I don't think we have the time. I think we have run out of course because the banking system is stressed. Enough taxpayer money has gone into it. And I don't think government has the flexibility to put in another 50 billion into the banking system. There are other things they need to do. You know, the domestic enterprise are stressed. There's lack of capital. You know, funds that Srini manages, I manage, everything. This is all international LPs. So let's tap into those capital. And the only thing they want is just create the framework. You know, the framework right now is broken. The framework does not allow the capital structure to work the way it should work. You know, equity gets wiped out, debt gets converted to equity. The new debt coming in has to get super senior priority. Like, it's not tough to understand. But somewhere people are not willing to bell the cat and create that level playing field. What Swami Fund has got should be given to everybody. Like, what's the downside on that? I don't get it. So I think overall, the solution is very simple. We can debate it 100 times. You'll come to the same answer. Like, you can ask every child in the class, what is 2 plus 2? The answer is 4. Like, there's no point asking that question again and again. So maybe it sounds complex and I'm oversimplifying it, but it is not as complex. Like, we have debated this endlessly on multiple forums. And I think if we can fix the framework, India can solve it in 5 years and not take like another 25, 30 years to solve it in an inefficient way. The other important point is that if we do aspire to grow at 8 or 10%, you have to lower the cost of capital. Like, no country in this world has ever grown at the cost of capital that India has, especially for resolving NPLs and high yield. Government has done a great job bringing down cost of capital for itself. GSEC rates for 5 years are like 5%. You know, it's unheard of, probably a record. You know, AAA borrowers are today borrowing 3-year money at under 4%. Like, India has done a great job, you know, obviously creating and bringing a lot of investment grade stuff to low cost capital. But I think we're just struggling to do it at the high yield and NPL side. And it's just tough. If you have less capital, the cost of capital is going to be more. So you're going to get capital at 18, 20 or whatever, north of 20%. But if you allow the framework to open up, the cost of capital will come down, not by 50, 100 basis points. It could come down materially, and we've seen it in capital markets, we've seen it in bond markets, we've seen it in retail mortgages. Allow the capital to come in. I think we've put artificial barriers, which we want to remove, but we don't know how to remove it. But there are simple answers to it. So I think, you know, that's my take. There's enough more capital. Just have to kind of finally bell the cat. You know, if there are 5 people who need to decide, let it be 5 people. If there are 50 people, it's 50 people. They are all Indians. They're all sitting with 5-6 organizations, you know, and they can fix it if they want to. And
we appreciate that, Nipun. You know, what is it that is absolutely exciting for you in the current times? I mean, you've been at it for over 2 decades. What is it that draws your maximum attention and bandwidth and capital, attraction?
I think we are, you know, having been investing in markets for a long time, it boils down to risk and reward. You know, I'm not a fan of office or commercial or I don't care, really. It's a function of where the risk reward sits. You know, if you're getting better risk reward doing NPLs, that's great. You know, if you're doing better risk rewards doing portfolio of loans, you know, just from banks and financial institutions who want to sell down, maybe that's the solution. Or it could be in last mile financing. It could be anything. I think we are not allowing the risk reward to work. You know, the risk has to be brought down in the system. The systemic risk, you know, the systemic risk, which is the systematic risk, that's kind of still out there. We could come in as a lender into a deal, but if you go into IBC, you will be pari passu with the existing lenders. So there goes your whatever you were trying to do. So it's the systematic risk is not being taken away, and that's why it's not working. We could play across any asset class as long as risk reward works once the system and framework is in place.
I appreciate it. So you know, I'm going to go across the panel and ask that one thing that is most exciting or one outcome that has happened to your business model because of the pandemic, and how do you see the opportunity framing for yourself in 2021, given that we're looking at a positive GDP growth for our nation in the coming year? Starting with you, Srini.
Yeah, I think the best outcome is everybody has had the time to sit at home for the last 9 months and think about what they want to do. And many of us have, you know, had a reality check, and pun intended, reality and reality both. Okay. So people are, you know, happy to do transactions at more sensible numbers, even though I wouldn't say that of all landlords in this country, but in general, the rest of the ecosystem has come down to reality, and that's good.
Anita?
I think I would echo what Srini said. I think, you know, it's time to get down, or, you know, kind of roll up your sleeves and get down to doing good work. So yeah, that's about it.
Nipun?
Remember to unmute. I think the opportunity set is too large to define it. Like you said, 200 billion, like what do you want to pick? So I think it's kind of pretty much, there's it's a a la carte menu. You can have, you know, what you want for breakfast, lunch, dinner.
So do you think that you're better off post the pandemic to actually pick up transactions and look at more attractive valuations and returns thereof? Is there more rationality?
I think that's a perception. Like there's this whole lot of thing. I don't think things will trade that way. I think you have to create that framework for things to function. Market forces are not being allowed to function the way they should. Bilaterally on the margin, I think deal making will happen, and you know, it'll happen mostly with institutions. That is very clear. You know, this is the first time that real estate deals will get done not with developers but with lenders or existing institutions. It'll be a tripartite deal than a bipartite deal. So as long as, you know, everybody's can kind of create a solution around that, you know, we are pretty keen, and I think it's sizable. There's enough to do, but it will create it in a tripartite manner.
Absolutely. Any other closing remarks, Nipun, from your end?
No, I think I've said enough.
Okay, excellent.
Hopefully, message is gone and
absolutely, loud and clear. So thank you very much, Srini, Nipun, Nita. I think it's been an extraordinary panel. I appreciate the patience you've had in actually being here today with us. It's been a spectacular day at Reese since this afternoon. I think we were right in the middle of that when the momentum has only built up. You've obviously caused a lot of excitement and flutter across the board with your comments and with your very, very candid views. Just to sort of very quickly summarize, Srini has been very categorical in stating that the structure of IBC is not apt for real estate. There needs to be alternate mechanisms for resolution. It is something which will not work if you only go through the IBC model, something which Nipun has also echoed. He's asked for parity with the SWAMI fund as far as the IBC is concerned, if it continues to be a model for resolution, as is also asked for parity in terms of buying assets or buying loans to be able to consolidate the sector when you have large special situations like what he sits on. Clearly, consolidation can happen through funds like him, provided the regulatory framework is fixed. And he's very, very happy to work with the most able developers to be able to buy assets, consolidate them, and earn adequate returns. It is not going to be cheap money, guys. Also, Srini has very clearly spelled out that there has been a reality check. Post the pandemic, I think there is a lot more realism, potentially, which has stepped in. People are more amenable to the right valuations, are more amenable to resolve assets than sit on it, despite the moratorium. I think Nita has clearly spelled out that the ARC has been around for 18 years, has been most institutionally
develop a model and platform for resolution of stressed assets. There's been a great time with foreign investors and large LPs who are part of her ecosystem as well, who are looking to step in, are stepping in to acquire stressed assets and, and from banking system and resolve them in a period of time. However, having said that, she also believes that real estate is far more complex because of the number of moving parts it involves, including the construction liabilities and homeowner liabilities, and need a lot more skills at the investor and the ERC level to be able to grow and acquire these assets. I think Neeta has clearly spelled it out that while ERCs would be interested, they'll need to buy time for funds like Nipun and Srini to take the first bait and teach the industry how things will work. Nipun has been obviously very, very spectacular and candid in saying, where is the lack of money? The world is awash with funds. India is not getting enough. Real estate is not getting enough. He's given fantastic examples from e-commerce, insurance, and DFI sector, seeing how valuations have run amok and abound. But that's not something which is witnessed because market making is still happening in the margins. It's not mainstream. And the singular reason he's pointed out in a very, very cryptic way, of course, is that the framework is broken. We'll need a lot more from Nipun to understand how to fix that framework, of course, but we don't have time. But clearly the framework is broken. It is not allowing NPAs to be dealt with in a mainstream manner as would be expected for large capital to come. Clearly, there is money. Of course, I think one other spectacular comment was that we have seen the lowest credit cost environment in the current times, which has allowed cost of capital to come down and more capital to come in despite that. However, there's not enough capital in the high yield and the NPA space. Very surprising, but a fact of life. Clearly, because of the infrastructure and framework not being available to transact in that space. I think Nipun has said that there's a very, very big buffet from what you can choose from. How you deal with it may be clearly an opportunistic bet, and that is unfortunately or fortunately the mantra for NPAs. It is still a very, very opportunistic space. It is not a mainstream space, but having said that, it is likely to mature and grow, which makes this panel so much more relevant in today's times. We're at the cusp of consolidation of NPAs or special situations or pre-stressed and stressed assets. And we have three leaders who are leading the way. Thank you very, very much, guys. I much appreciate the time and I hope to see you and talk to you again. Cheers.
Thank you so much, Amit. We could not have asked for a better moderator, perfect moderating. And thank you so much, guests, Neeta ji, Nipun, Srini. A heartfelt thanks from Aptu and Redco. Thank you so much. And do try and stay on for the continuing sessions as well.